Good morning. Good morning again, everybody. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Take a grip, right? Take a grip, my brother. Take a grip. Not you. Hold on and never let go, right? No matter what the people in the world may say, hold on. Right, right, right. So good morning, everybody, and welcome to another Youth Service Sunday. Yeah, man, let me hear the noise and what the young people them. They make some noise, man. Yeah, man. Thank you, Sister Darkus. I know that you are young at heart. I know that you are young at heart. So good morning, everybody. Good morning, good morning, good morning. And we welcome you to another Youth Sunday. And today is our Youth Empowerment Sunday. So this Sunday is for the youths, by the youths. Amen? Amen. I am your moderator for this morning. My name is Brother Navaria Barrett. So I pray that you will be blessed. Youth Pastor Navaria Barrett. So I pray that you will be blessed this morning as we go forward into this service. Amen? Amen. Amen. So as we go forward, we'll be asking Sister Renee Ellison to do today's opening prayer. So come, my sister.
Good morning, everybody. How are we doing this morning? Awesome, awesome, awesome. All right, so I'll be doing the opening prayer. Can I invite everyone to stand? Now, we know that in everything that we do, we put the Lord first. And at this time, I just want to, you know, even though I know he's here, but I just want to acknowledge the Holy Spirit and officially welcome him. And just invite him to go before us as we continue in our service. So Heavenly Father, I come before you even now, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, we lift up your name on high because you, Lord, are worthy to be praised and adored. Mighty God, there is no one like unto you. There's no one that can be compared to you, mighty God. And there you have no rival, mighty God. So even now, mighty God, we worship you and you only. So even now, mighty God, we just invite your Holy Spirit to come, to rest, remain, and abide with us. Even now, Holy Spirit, yes, Lord, we know we have our program. But Lord, we know in all that we do, mighty God, it is done in adoration and it's to worship and to give praise unto you, mighty God. And if you're not a part of it, mighty God, it means nothing. So even now, mighty God, I just ask you to be with us, mighty God. Cover the preacher, mighty God. She's on her way, mighty God, wherever she is, mighty God. We just extend your Holy Spirit even now to cover her, to cover her under your blood, mighty God, and guide her as she makes her way here, mighty God. Lord, we put the proceedings of this service in your hands. Mighty God, we cover the moderator, we cover the praise team, the musician, mighty God, and every single person, mighty God, that is coming up here to minister, Heavenly Father, because in all that we do, Lord, we acknowledge you and we put you first. Even now, mighty God, I come against every single distraction, mighty God, that sets up itself, mighty God, to cause a hindrance and the flow of this service, even now, mighty God. Every single thing that is hovering over in our atmosphere, mighty God, we shift it now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord, you are God. And we acknowledge you, mighty God. And we ask you, even now, mighty God, to saturate this place, even now, mighty God. And I pray, even now, mighty God, as your people, mighty God, we'll tune in our hearts to you, mighty God. Put away the distraction, mighty God. Every single thing that is not concerning you, mighty God. We pray, even now, that we as your saints, mighty God, we put it away, mighty God. And tune our focus on you, Heavenly Father. Lord, we pray a lot that we want you to take over, mighty God. But if our hearts are not in the correct posture, mighty God, you will not have your way. So even now, mighty God, we put ourselves in the position, mighty God, to receive from you, mighty God. We put ourselves, mighty God, in the place, mighty God, that you may have your way. We shift our focus this morning, even Almighty God. Lord, we give you thanks for another day, because today was not promised, Mighty God. A lot of persons are homeless, Mighty God. A lot of persons are sweeping out water, Mighty God. But Lord, many of us are not in that position. So Lord, we give you thanks even now. And as we come, Mighty God, to worship and to praise you, Mighty God, I pray that we do so in spirit and in truth, Mighty God, as if tomorrow is not promised, Mighty God. Because Lord, many of us, Mighty God, started this week and has not completed it, Mighty God. So Lord, I pray that we do not take this opportunity for granted, Mighty God, but every single chance that we get to worship and to praise you, Mighty God, I pray, Lord, that we make the most of it. Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise even now, Mighty God, because you alone, Mighty God, are deserving of our worship and our praise. So we pray that you have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. You may be seated. Well, not really. You can continue to stand, because at this time we'll be having our scripture reading, and it will be taken from St. Matthew 25 from verse 14 to 30, and it will be read by Kamoya Lindo and Kellyanne Harris. So make them welcome.
Church, the scripture reading will be taken from Matthew 25 verses 14 to 30, and it reads, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods.
And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey.
Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them other 5 talents.
And likewise he that had received 2, he always gained other 2.
But he that had received 1 went and dig in the earth and hid his Lord's money.
After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them.
And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more.
His Lord said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.
He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them.
His Lord said unto him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.
Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not strawed.
And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine.
His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gathered where I have not strawed.
Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury.
Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents.
For unto everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance, but from him that hath not shall be taken away, and even that which he hath.
30 and last. And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
This is the word
of
the Lord.
Here ended a portion of God's holy word. We say thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Give them a round of applause, everybody. You know, it's not easy for them to come up and really read the Bible. Because even for me, myself, even standing here, it is very nerve-wracking. Not true? Yeah, man, it's very nerve-wracking. So at this time, I'll be inviting the praise and worship team to come up again. Yeah, as we go into today's congregational hymn, and it is He Abides. He Abides? He Abides. I'm asking all the other persons, like Sister Charmin, she's here? Oh, she's inside doing something. Okay, all right. So come, my praise and worship teams, as we go into today's congregational hymn.
Bless the Lord, church. I'm going to ask you to help us sing this one as we give some praise to the Lord. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the pilgrim way, for the hand of God in all my life I see.
You see?
And the reason of my bliss, yes, the secret all is this, that the Comforter abides with me.
He abides, He abides. Hallelujah, He abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me.
Once my heart was full of sin, once I had no peace within, still heard Jesus died upon the very tree. Then I fell down at His feet, and there came a peace so sweet.
For the Comforter abides with me. Oh, He abides, He abides. Oh, hallelujah, He abides with me. Oh, I'm rejoicing night
and day as I walk the narrow way, for the Comforter abides with me. He's with me everywhere. For the Spirit has control. Jesus satisfies my soul. Since the Comforter abides with me.
Yeah.
one more time. He abides. He abides. Oh, he abides. Oh, hallelujah. He abides with me. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the narrow way. For the Comforter abides with me.
Hallelujah. The Comforter abides with me. Amen. Amen. He abides. He abides. Hallelujah. He abides with me. So at this time, I will be calling for the youths, for they will be doing a role play. And you know that today is Stewardship Month, right? And the Bible speaks about talents. So we're going to see how the talents of the youth showcase here in front of you to encourage the brethren about stewardship. Amen? Amen. So let us get ourselves ready.
Long time ago, there lived a wealthy man and his three servants in the kingdom of Kingston. One day, the wealthy man was going on a long journey and he called his three servants to give them some special gifts.
So what going, my bros?
All right.
You know, so me I go up on a journey and me have some special gifts to give unto you three, right? So hear what now. Because you are one of my trusted servants, I'll be giving you 5 talents, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you're going to work on the talent for me?
Yes, sir. Now let it go.
All right. No problem. No problem. Because you are also one of my trusted servants, I'll be giving you 2 talents. You going to work on the talent for me?
Yes, sir.
You sure about that?
Yes, sir.
You sure about it?
Yes, sir.
All right, no problem. Because you are also one of my trusted talent servant, I'll be giving you 1 talent.
1 talent, really, bro? Really, boss, man? Try on, man. Any work on something I can do with it still.
Don't worry yourself, man. Don't worry yourself. Just work on the talent for me, all right? I got to go up on the journey. I'm a soon come back. So I have to go and go work on it for me there. Please and thanks.
So the wealthy man went away on his journey, leaving the servants to work on their talents. The first servant went and invested his talents in some business and got double the amount. The second servant also invested in some businesses and doubled the amount. But the third servant didn't think too much about his 1 talent, so he buried it. When the wealthy man returned from his journey, he asked for a report about the talents he gave to his servants.
Servants, I am back from my journey. on a day. Come talk to me, man. Talk to me, man. I have given you my talents. So let me hear the good news that you are, what you have done. Come, how much money you get?
$1,000.
$1,000? So where do you go and go into the business and double your money?
Yes, sir.
Your mama tell us you are the real one, you know. You are the real G. What about you?
You know, so I'm investing in it. I'm going to get 10 talent. Yeah, man, fully talented.
10 talent? No, sure, not the 4 you get?
No, man.
No, 4 of 10 talent you get, right? Yeah, yeah. Or you get the 4, not you? All right,
yes,
so what about you?
You know what I'm saying? I'm thinking about it still, you know, and you know what I'm saying? I never did too want to use it, you know, and getting a blast, you know, so I'm just very talented. You know?
So I bury my money, brother?
Yeah, I never want to lose it.
That's it, but I think you would have taken my talent to something better with that, my youth. You could have used it and invested in something else. And that you really take my talent and do?
I never want to disappoint you, so I just...
Ah, you what? Just give me my money. Give me my talent.
Come, no.
Just give me my talent.
Really, bro?
Just give me my talent. I'll be taking it and give it to this one because he has worked beautiful for my kingdom. So just excuse yourself out of my presence.
Real?
Yeah, man. Just excuse yourself out of my presence. Come here, my virgins. Let us continue working for the vineyard.
So the one who took the one talent, he was ushered out of the presence of the ruler. So in conclusion, the parable of the talent serves as a powerful lesson about stewardship, responsibility, and the importance of using one's gifts and abilities wisely. The master in the story represents God, who entrust each individual with unique talents. The varying amounts of talents symbolize the diverse abilities and opportunities given to people. The parable challenges us to reflect on how we are utilizing the resources and abilities that have been bestowed upon us. It encourages a sense of responsibility and diligence, emphasizing that our actions matter and that we are accountable for the use of our talents. The story also underscores the concept of investing in the kingdom of God, suggesting that our efforts should contribute positively to the greater good and not be buried or wasted. Ultimately, the parable of the talents calls for a proactive and purposeful approach to life, urging individuals to embrace their gifts, take risks, and work diligently towards fruitful outcomes. It is a timeless reminder to be faithful stewards of the blessings we have received, recognizing that in doing so, we contribute to the unfolding of God's plan and the flourishing of the world around us. Let us be good stewards for the Lord. God bless.
Amen, amen, amen. Blessings, everybody. Can I give them a round of applause? Yes, man. And that is the story that we want to really bring across for today, as it is, we are celebrating the whole aspect and concept of stewardship. That we have to learn to manage and work on our talents, right? We can't really take the talents and just bury them, because the very moment we do that, we will lose them. So we have to use these talents, even if it's even one you have, work on them to use that to build upon the kingdom of God. Amen? 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 Amen. Yeah, man. So at this time, we'll be doing our second scripture reading. And it will be taken from Genesis 1:28, and that will be read by Jermaine Brown. Make your way up, Jermaine Brown. The second reading will be taken from Genesis 2:15, and I will be reading that, and also 1 Peter 4, verse 10, and I will be doing that reading also. So let us all stand for today's reading.
Good morning, church. The scripture reading will be taken from Genesis chapter 1, verses 28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Here ends the portion of God's holy word.
It's And I will be reading Genesis 2, verse 15. And it says, And the Lord took the man and put him in the garden to dress it and keep it, right? So he took him to dress it and keep it. So that is the whole aspect of managing the gifts of God. The third scripture will be taken from 1 Peter 4. And that will be 1 Peter 4, verse 10. Sorry about that, guys. So the scripture reading will be taken from 1 Peter 4, verses 10. And I will be reading that scripture for us this morning. And it reads thus. As every man hath received the gift, even so the ministers minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold of grace. And this is a portion of God's holy word. Are we honored by saying? Blessed be the name of the Lord. So at this time, we will be going into a time of giving. And right after the time of giving, we'll be asking the persons for the sign language to make themselves ready. And right after that, we will be asking Leanna Gale to go to pray for the tithes, to pray for the offering and the speaker. And they will be going into the deep worship. And the next voice you will hear is Pastor Sophie Mayer. So I'll be asking the praise and worship team to make themselves available again for the time of giving. So you're ready to worship in your tithes and offering, everybody? You're ready to worship in your tithes and offering, right? Yeah, man. So let us get ourselves ready as we go forward to worshiping our giving. So ushers, make yourselves ready.
Bless the Lord. As we're on the theme of stewardship, we must also remember that we steward God's kingdom by our giving. It helps to further the work of God. So let us go ahead and sing this one as we give out of our abundance, which God has blessed us. Amen. Giving brings a release.
Giving brings a release. A release for your miracles. Giving brings a release. Giving brings a release. Giving brings a release. A release for your miracles. Giving brings a release.
The more you give to God, the more He gives to you. Giving brings a release.
The more you give to God, the more He gives to you.
Safia, Gail, come and pray for today's tithes and offering, and also pray for the speaker. And right after the prisoner, the sign language group will be ministering for us.
Lord, as we come before you this morning, even now, Lord, I thank you for who have it to give today, even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would bless who didn't have it to give. Lord, I pray that our basket will never be empty, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray our basket will overflow with blessings, even now, Lord God. Our speaker, Lord Jesus, for this morning, Lord, I pray that as she makes her way, Lord, I pray that you continue to bless us throughout this service, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you would help us to have our hearts in tune even now, Lord God. Lord, our speaker, Lord, I pray that you bless her in a special way even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you continue to guide her and protect her even now, Lord God. Lord, I pray that you continue to open doors for her, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that you bring her into rooms that she's never been into even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, as we're about to start a new week, Lord Jesus, Lord, I pray that you'd bless her even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for new miracles, new opportunities, new blessings, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for her family even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that no weapon formed against them shall ever prosper even now. Lord, every tongue that rises up against them shall be put to judgment even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that every plan the enemy has against her and her family even now, Lord Jesus, we cramp and paralyze it even now. Every principality, Lord Jesus, every negative word that is spoken over her life, over her family's life, Lord Jesus. Lord, I cancel it and we call it not even now, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray that as we proceed through this service even now, Lord, I pray that you'd have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. We are waging war, right? Amen. And that is one thing that we want to encourage our youths, you know, to use up their talents that the Lord has given unto them, to really stamp and paralyze the kingdom of darkness. Amen. Amen. Because we have to understand that we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but we are fighting against principalities and powers and darkness in high places. Not true? Yeah, man. So we have to encourage them to use their talents to uplift and to build the kingdom of God. So as at this time, I'll be asking the praise and worship team to make themselves available again as we go into a time of worship before the speaker starts. So just as you sit there this morning, I hope that you are praying for us, because as we say, it's not easy to really stand up here, and sometimes, you know, things might happen, circumstances might come our way, but we still have to push forward, you know, in this time. So let us get our hearts prepared and ready for worship this morning. You're ready to worship the Lord this morning? Talk to me, man. You're ready to worship the Lord this morning? Talk to me, man. I'm not hearing it. You're ready to worship the Lord this morning? Amen. 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 Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done. Of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. You deserve the glory and the honor. So we lift our worship as we praise your holy name, for you deserve the glory and the honor. So we lift our hands in worship as we praise your holy name. Let us sing it again. You deserve the glory and the honor.
And the honor.
So we lift our hands in worship as we praise your holy name. For you deserve the glory and the honor. So we lift our hands in worship as we praise your holy name. For you. Everybody sing. Let me hear the voices. Let me hear the voices.
You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
Let me hear the voices.
Other souls.
Hallelujah.
To worship you. You are God. And God alone.
Hallelujah.
We lift our hearts to you. Oh God, you are God alone. You are God and God alone. You are God and God alone. You are God and God alone. You are God. And God alone.
Let everybody sing it.
You are God. And God alone.
Everybody sing. You are God.
And you are God. And God alone. You are God. And God alone.
You are God.
You are God and God alone.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness. Holiness is what you are for me. For me.
Take my
holiness is what I long for.
Everybody.
Holiness is what I need. It's what you want for me, so take my heart,
and hold it, take my heart, transform it, take my
righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want for me. So for me.
Your
is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want as we are still in the frame of mind of worship. I hope that you are still praying for the speaker as we continue to reach after the word of God. So let us all welcome the speaker this morning, Pastor Sophie Mayer. Everybody give her a round of applause. Bless you, Pastor. Bless you.
Praise the Lord. I think that we're in a flow. Hallelujah. We're in a flow. We're in a flow. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Yeah. I don't want to miss out on the presence. Come on. Hallelujah. We're still in a flow. We're still in a flow. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord. Worship your name, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, we worship you. We bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, we worship you. We worship you, we worship you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Lord, you are worthy. You'll be seated in a while. Just stand with me for a little bit. And no one can worship you for me. Hallelujah. All the things you've done for me. And no one can worship you for me. One more time. You, Lord. You, Lord. You, Lord.
You, Lord. You are worthy. Yeah. And no one can worship you for me.
Oh, the thing, Lord.
All the things you've done for me.
Hallelujah. No one else.
No one can worship.
One more time. You, Lord, you, Lord, you, Lord. One more time. You, Lord.
You, Lord, you are worthy.
Oh, Lord.
No one can worship you.
Me, Lord,
all the things you've done for me,
no one,
and no one can worship you for me.
So here is my word.
Worship,
receive my worship.
All I
Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are welcome here. Hallelujah. Angels of the living God, you are welcome here. Oh, hallelujah. Hey, hallelujah. Hallelujah. We bless him today. Amen. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Bless the Lord. What a sweet spirit. What a sweet spirit in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm giving God thanks. Praise the name of Jesus. I want to extend greetings to our moderator for this service. Bless you, man of God. I also want to extend greetings to the senior pastor of this local church and also our parish administrative assistant, Bishop Rudolph Daly. To your pastor, Pastor Marjorie Williams. To all of the ministers in the house, bless the name of the Lord. All of the ministers, Minister Dawn, Minister Dorcas, Minister Hunter, Minister Gray, Minister, all of the ministers, amen. Your ministry team, which includes your deacons and so forth, and all of the wonderful brethren from the Maxfield Avenue Church of God of Prophecy. Amen. 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 Somebody shout with Deya. Come on, me never hear that. With there. Amen, amen. I want to acknowledge that this season has been a very difficult season for your church. It has been a very difficult season. Some unexpected transitions, and sometimes the ways of the Lord are far above what we can understand. But we still have to trust that He knows what He's doing. But I just want to acknowledge that it has been such a season. I've been asked this morning to talk to us. I'm not preaching. I've been asked to talk to us. And as I was preparing to come this morning, I received some instructions as to how we're going to talk together. So it's really not going to be so much of a preaching or of me just lecturing, but rather it's going to be an engagement this morning. Because I recognize that all of us, we have knowledge and wisdom deep down on the inside of us. And so we are going to engage each other this morning. So I'm going to be asking your tech persons to assist. They're going to be having some roving mics. And we're going to learn together. We're going to talk together. We're going to minister together. Amen? I've been asked to talk about stewardship. Stewardship. And for my topic this morning, my topic is stewardship more than money. Stewardship more than money. And the truth is that many times when we hear the word stewardship, immediately what comes to our minds is money. And that's good. It's good that what's coming to our minds is money. But at the same time, stewardship is really broader and wider than money. Amen? Can I get an amen? Amen. So the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to turn to Matthew, my base text. And I say base text because I really have a lot of texts. How long am I going to have? 3 o'clock? That all right? Okay. All right. My base text. No, my devices are about to run out of charge, so I might have to pull on a King James Bible. But let's go on in the meantime. So Matthew chapter 25, we're going to start from verse 14. Thank you. Whoa, big print. Nice. Holy Spirit, thank you. All right, so Matthew chapter 25, and we're going to start from verse 14. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them other 5 talents. And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art a hard man, very feisty, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. See it, your God. See the one where you give me. His Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury or interest. Take therefore the talent from him and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath. And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Those were the words of Jesus. Amen. Bless the name of the Lord. It is amazing to me that we tend to relegate stewardship and the preaching of stewardship to a month. I am guilty, because the month of October in my local church is known as Stewardship Month, and that is the month that we spend a lot of time preaching on stewardship. But guess what? In my studies and looking at stewardship, I have come to recognize that stewardship is actually one of the primary or first theological constructs, theological doctrines in the Bible. Stewardship. Before salvation, there was stewardship. Before repentance, there was stewardship. So, am I going to prove my point? All right, let's look at it. But before I actually get there, I want us to understand what we are talking about when we use the term steward or stewardship. Steward or stewardship. So where's my roving mic? So I'm going to start off. I'm going to ask a few persons. Don't be shy. We are engaging each other. I want you to give me a definition of who a steward is. Is or what is stewardship? What's your understanding of stewardship? Don't be shy. Any takers?
Dork. Mm-hmm. Stewardship is really taking care of something. And I am reminded that everything that we have been given to us is by God.
Yes.
So we are indeed to be good steward of taking care of what was given to us by God.
Thank you. Anybody else? Who is a steward? What is stewardship?
Stewardship is taking care of someone else's property. Stewardship is taking care of someone else's property.
Yes, stewardship is taking care of someone else's property. Love it. Anybody else? Any other takers? I'll take two more. Mm-hmm. One more person. Two more persons. I need a young person too.
Morning, church.
Morning.
Stewardship could be service we offer to someone like the sick or whoever, hospitality, as well as in the hospital. Or
okay, all right. So stewardship is about offering service, right? Like somebody in the hospital. Thank you for that. All right, I want a young person. I want one of the youngsters. It's youth service this morning.
Managing someone's property.
Wow. Wow, wow, wow. All right. Thank you very much. And just to say that all of those definitions are absolutely correct. All right. So when we talk about stewardship or a steward, it is, first of all, utilizing and managing all resources God provides for the glory of God and the betterment of his creation. Let me read that one again. Utilizing and managing all resources God provides for the glory of God and the betterment of his creation. So, from that definition, we see that first and foremost, it is for the glory of God. But not only that, stewardship is all about the betterment of his creation. All right? A steward in the ancient world was a person who was given the responsibility and authority to rule over the affairs of the household. So the steward is somebody, note the word, someone who has been given responsibility and authority. So what comes with stewardship? Stewardship comes with responsibility and authority. So you have been authorized to manage the resources of God. Very important. We look, for example, at Joseph, who became a steward over Potiphar's household. And he managed everything in the household and was given the authority to rule over his house. Now, especially for my young people, if you remember the story of Joseph, when Joseph managed Potiphar's household, there were two other places that Joseph was now able to manage apart from Potiphar's household. Anybody can tell me the two places other than Potiphar's household that he ended up managing? And I'm going to make a point later down about Joseph. Yes. Give me some more.
He managed Pharaoh, he was in charge of Pharaoh, the people of Israel.
Right, the people, right? So he became the steward of Pharaoh. Israel, so yes. He started out as Potiphar's steward, but then he ended up becoming Pharaoh's steward, right?
And remember, you know, we are talking about managing someone's resources. So, and based on the definition, Joseph was given the responsibility and the authority to manage Pharaoh's resources. Can you believe it? There was one other thing that he became a steward of. Anybody can tell me?
The prison.
The prison. Thank you very much, bright lady. Yes, when Joseph was in prison, the prison guard, the head of the prison guards, he gave the responsibility and the authority to Joseph to manage the prisoners. So you see, brethren, it doesn't matter where you are, you know. It doesn't matter where you are. Once you step into a place, we are stewards and we should be stewards of God's. Okay. So, a steward, as many have said, is someone who manages or looks after another's property. All right? One who looks after or manages another person's property. We're going to get into some scriptures, so don't worry. So I just want to make a few points before we get down into some scriptures. So anything, I want you to listen carefully to this. Anything that we are a steward of means that we prevent it from falling apart. We keep it orderly. We maintain it. We preserve it. And we make it beautiful. I want to read that again, you know. Anything that we are a steward of means that we prevent it from falling apart. We keep it orderly. We maintain it and preserve it, and we make it beautiful. Now, let me see all the married men stick your hand up. Married men, married men, married men. Thank you very much. Now, listen, I'm coming to the wives, you know, so you can put your hand down. Married men, you hear your responsibility that you are supposed to preserve your wife. You're supposed to keep her from falling apart. You're supposed to make sure that she is beautiful. Because you are now the steward of your wife. God has given... stand up here, sweetheart. Stand up. Make them see you. Make them see if the man is preserving her. Making her beautiful. Come on. But ladies, you think you get away? Let me see all the married ladies. All the married ladies, put your hands up. Put your hands up. All right. Now, Maxfield, you know each other, and you must tell me if these ladies are being good stewards of their husbands, ensuring that their husband's not falling apart, that them look handsome and nice and well dapper. Look here, mommy daily. Where is she? I know she's not here right now. But if you're watching mommy daily, look here, look upon the man. Look at the man, right? Mommy daily no make Bishop come out of the house without him look proper. Very, very proper. Amen. She ensures that he's preserved. Not just in the way that he looks. But mommy D make sure that him diet proper. Him not eat no foolishness. Because she wants to ensure that he lives long, right? The primary beneficiary of our stewardship must always be God. Primary. He must be glorified. Right? But we are also beneficiaries of stewardship. Yes, we are beneficiaries too. Because we are supposed to be stewarding God's creation. And if we are faithful in being good stewards, then eventually those benefits are going to trickle down to us. I believe that we are in a crisis now where the world is concerned. Because the truth is, in many instances, we have not been good stewards of the earth. Am I talking truth? Am I talking truth? So here's my next engagement. I want you to give me some examples of how we have not been, where's my young people? How we have not been good stewards of the earth. Give me some examples.
Pollution.
Yes, you hear that one? Pollution. Who else? Bishop said climate change.
Yes, deforestation.
Deforestation.
Crime and violence.
Crime and violence. Mm-hmm. How else? How else have we not been good stewards? Those are some wonderful examples of how we have not been good stewards of the earth. Deforestation, and even in Jamaica, we have a lot of landslides many times because of deforestation. You were going to say?
Improper disposal of garbage.
Oh my God. Improper disposal of our waste. Come, that little young one is ready to say something. See him there? See him there?
Scammers.
Listen to me about the scammers. The scammers. Huh? The scammers. They are not good stewards. Mm-mm. Why? Because, listen, can I, Moana, young man, stand up. Stand up for me, sweetheart. You have said such a profound thing. The scammers. And you know why it's so profound? Because remember, you know, the definition of a steward is somebody who has been given the responsibility as well as the authority. Right? No. Did anybody authorize these people to go into somebody else's account? They're bad stewards. So we have not been stewarding the earth as we should. All right? So, the mangroves. Right? Not taking care of the mangroves. Right? Not being good stewards. Come again? Paying tithes. Talk your talk. Bishop, you hear that? Paying tithes, not being good stewards because of not paying tithes as we ought to pay tithes. Maxfield, I'm learning a lot from you. So we have been given the responsibility to steward the planet. We have been given the responsibility to steward the planet. And I'll be honest with you. I have been looking into myself. I remember younger days when we used to hear about these Greenpeace people and these people who were always talking about the environment, and we used to say, why don't just stop talking and keep quiet and then just run up their mouth and all of that. But we have come to see how important it is when you have an oil spill in the sea, how much damage. When we talk about fish kill, I'm not being political here, but when there is all kind of things going into the sea and the fish die, stewardship. That's what we're talking about this morning, stewardship. So listen, stewardship is a belief that humanity is responsible for the world. Who is responsible for the world? No, I thought it was God was responsible for the world. Humanity is responsible for the world. Humanity and the gifts and resources that have been entrusted to us. Yes. So in Jewish, Christian, and Muslim traditions, stewardship refers to the way time, talents, which is giftings, material possessions, or wealth are used or given for the service of God. My sister down there spoke about service. So hear what now. It is not just for us to use the resources that come to us for ourselves. Let me tell the church, the wealth that comes into your hands is not just for you to buy Bima and one $50 million house. No, $50 million house cheap, right? One $200 million house. and you wear, you have 500 pair of shoes, huh? Listen to me, the wealth that comes into our hands is so that we can give service to our God. That's what true stewardship is all about. Essentially, it is managing everything God. Essentially, it is managing everything God brings into the believer's life in a manner that honors God and impacts eternity. Come on now, church. Not just to honor God, but it needs to have an impact on eternity. Stewardship begins and ends with the understanding of God's ownership of everything. So let's read some scriptures. Where are my readers? Yes, I'm ready. Where are my readers? So I want you to we're talking about the fact that God is the owner of everything. So my readers, I want somebody to find Revelation 22 and verse 13. Somebody else find Psalm 24 and verse 1. Somebody find Deuteronomy 10 and verse 14. Luke 25 and verse 23. Job 41 and verse 11. All right. In any order. So the first person that has found that scripture, just put your hand up for the mic. See my sister here. Oh, you have the mic, so when you finish, pass it over. Which one you're reading?
Revelation 22, verse 13. Mm-hmm. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last.
All right. Remember, we are talking about the fact that God owns everything. Yes. Next person.
Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein.
Thank you. The earth is whose own? The Lord's. All right. Next one. Who is the next person? Next reader.
Deuteronomy 10, verse 14. Behold, the heavens of heavens is the Lord thy God. The earth also with all that therein is.
Thank you. The heavens belong to God. The earth is also his. Thank you. Yes. Next one. Leviticus 25, 23. Anybody got that one? Leviticus 25 and 23. Somebody get that one. Go ahead, my darling. Go ahead.
The land shall not be sold forever. For this land is mine, for ye are strangers and sojourners with me.
All right. So another translation of that is that the land is mine. You are just tenants. The land is mine. You are just tenants. And then the last one, Job 41 and verse 11. Job 41 and verse 11. That's the final one. Job 41 and verse 11.
Job 41 verse 11. Who hath prevented me that I should repay him? Whatsoever is under the whole heaven is mine.
Whatsoever is under the whole heaven is mine. So actually, your 100% salary is actually God's own, you know. He's just allowing you to steward 90% of it because 10 already belongs to him. So 10 already belongs to him, but he's allowing you the opportunity to steward the 90%, because everything under the heavens belongs to him. Now, let's go back to something that I said earlier. So I said that stewardship is actually just about the first doctrine in the scriptures. Before salvation, repentance, before prosperity, before marriage. All right, so there is a theological terminology called, or principle called, the law of first mention. The law of first mention. It just means that wherever you see a particular word, the first place, it usually gives a foundation of what that thing really means. All right? So we want to see where in the scriptures was the first mention of the word steward. All right? Now, let me just say that many times, even though a word is not mentioned in scripture, it doesn't necessarily mean that it is not there. So the first place where the word steward is mentioned is Genesis chapter 15. And am I quoting that right? Let me go. Genesis chapter 12, I believe. Let me go to it. Genesis 15 or Genesis 12, one of them. Let me go to Genesis 15 first. Genesis, all right, Genesis 15 and verse 2 is the first place in scripture where we see the word steward being used. So I'll read it. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus. The steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus. Now, if we remember that story well, Abram had no child. They were barren. Sarah was barren. There was no child, and yet God gave them a promise that he was going to make their seed as the sands of the sea and the sands of the earth. And Abram was saying, okay, I don't have any child. So in other words, can I make my steward, the one who manages my household, the primary person, can I make this person my heir? And we know the story that God said, no, he's not going to be your heir. I'm going to give you a child and so forth. So that is the first place. But I want to submit to us, church, that that is actually not the first place that we meet the word, or that we meet the concept of stewardship. Let's go to Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 26. Genesis chapter 1. And verse 26 and 27. All right, so we know that Genesis chapter 1 is talking about the creation. We have already established that God says that everything under the heavens belongs to him. And so Genesis chapter 1 is just detailing the creation, right? So we know that God made the light, and he made the stars, and he made the moon, and he made the animals, and he made the fish and the fowls and all of that. Now, verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and what? And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, what did he say? Be fruitful and multiply and do what? And replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Do you agree with me that the first theological theory in the scriptures, apart from the fact that God made the heavens and the earth, is that man, we are stewards. We are stewards of God's creation. Stewardship. The very first thing that we book upon is stewardship. You see what important it is? That God made us to be stewards over his creation. Oh my word. So listen now. I want us to look at some principles of stewardship. And we're going to look at some. So get ready to read some more scripture. All right? Get ready to read some more scripture. So we see in Genesis 1, 26 to 28, we see the whole issue of stewardship. First of all, we are image bearers. We have the likeness of God. Right? And we also see that we must be productive. So a part of stewardship is that we must be productive. You cannot have, if you have a lazy steward, if you have an unprofitable steward, if you have an unproductive steward, God does not, I'm not going to say the word, but God does not like that. Let me just be soft. God does not like that. All right? Because he created us to steward the creation. But we must never forget that we are not owners. We are never owners. We are not the owners. Amen. I want you to understand, Miss Married Person over there and Mr. Married Person over there, that wonderful woman that has been given to you, you don't own her, and she don't own you. Ultimately, she belongs to God, and so do you. Bishop and Pastor, just a reminder, you don't own this church. You don't own the people. You manage them. You steward them, but they belong to God. Thank you very much. So maybe as pastors, when them get trouble, we say, God, beat them now, God. Beat them now, God. All right. So listen, we're talking about principles of stewardship. I'm going to give you maybe two or three, and then I want you to start thinking as to what you think could be a principle of stewardship. So principle number one, and we're going to go back to Scripture all the way. Principle number one, the steward must follow the instructions of the owner. Genesis 2, 15 to 17. Somebody find that. Genesis 2, 15 to 17. Principle number one, the steward must follow the instructions of the owner. Yes, down there, somebody take the mic to minister, please.
Genesis 2.
15 to 17.
And the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, 17. For the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die.
Thank you. So the steward must follow the instructions of the owner. Listen, let's take it into the natural realm. If you have a business and you hire somebody to run your business, you're going to give instructions to the manager as to how you want to see the business run, don't it? If you are a hairdresser, any hairdresser in the house? Hairdresser. You know how you want the cut to look, what is your procedure of creaming the hair and so forth. So if somebody is going to manage your business, you're going to give them certain instructions. You're going to tell them, look here, I don't want you to put X in the client's hair. Okay? So that's principle number one. Principle number two. Second principle. The steward must be accountable to the owner. And that scripture is Genesis chapter 3, 9 to 11. Genesis 3, 9 to 11. The steward must be accountable to the owner. Okay, go ahead.
And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat?
So in other words, God is saying, have you eaten of the tree? So first the principle was, I'm giving instructions. You're not to eat of the tree. But the second thing is that when God gives instructions, we also have to be accountable to God for the instructions that he has given us. So he said, hold on there. Did you eat? Right? Okay. I'm going to give you the third one, and then I'm going to see if you can give me some more. So, number three, the steward must be productive. Principle number three. Principle number three. The steward must be productive. And we go back. We read it already in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. Right? The steward must be productive. All right. So I want to see your thinking caps on now. I want you to start thinking. Can you give me a few more principles that you think should apply to stewards? I've given you three. Can you think? Yes? Come on.
Responsibility.
A steward, I love it. A steward must be responsible. Thank you for that. Mommy Perkins, thank you for that. A steward must be responsible. Okay, honest. Yes?
Honest.
A steward must be honest. Yes. So when that steward is managing that shop and in the day $20,000 worth of profit came in that shop, but what they do? They take out two and slip under in a deer. Huh? So a steward needs to be honest. Yes, I love it. Yes.
Accountability.
A steward must be accountable. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Consistent.
Come again.
Consistent.
I love these people. A steward must be consistent. Look here. You cannot be doing the thing today, and then next month it drop down, and then you come back again, and then next month, oh Lord. So sometimes, Pastor Match, the tides this month, wassy, and then next month it gone down, and then 3 months it come up back again, and guess what? The JPS bill is very consistent. The water rate is very consistent. To pay the pastors is very consistent. So the stewards need to be consistent. Thank you.
Integrity.
Oh my God, the steward must have integrity. If you have integrity, it's going to lead you to be honest.
A keen listener.
The steward must be
a keen listener and obedient.
Thank you, because the instructions are coming from the owner. The owner says it must be done this way. Do you remember the story in Exodus where God gave the instructions as to how the priests are supposed to dress to go into the tabernacle, what it is that they're supposed to do? Do you remember that there were two sons of Aaron who decided that they were going to offer strange fire? What happened to them? Them get dead. They got died. The priests were dead in because they offered strange fire. You guys are on a roll anymore? What may I tell you?
Stewards should be good. Should be good parents, yes.
Stewards should be good parents.
That's one of them.
Yes.
And we should also be good witnesses.
Good witnesses.
Evangelizing, yes.
Thank you very much. So listen, one of the things that as Christians we have been given is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we are to be good stewards of the Great Commission. So we need to be good witnessers. I saw, there's such a word? Witnessers, witnessers. Witnesses, yeah, right? Right? But listen, Sister Hardy brought up a very important point. Parents. Every parent is a steward of your child. This is the gift of God that God has given you. And it is your responsibility, and you have been authorized to steward that child from infancy right up to adulthood and beyond too. Right? And beyond too. Yes.
Compassionate.
A steward needs to be compassionate. A steward needs to be compassionate. I'll take one more thing. Somebody's hand over here. Yes, go ahead.
A steward need to be loyal.
Loyal. Oh my gosh. Listen, do you know that businesses, my sister there, do you know that a lot of businesses are not thriving because they have a high staff turnover? Because they don't get people who are loyal. A steward needs to be loyal. That you can depend on them. They're going to be there. And especially in the kingdom of God. God needs some loyal stewards. Right? Let me see if I have a few more. Because you have exhausted it. But a steward must be faithful. Somebody read for me 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2. Okay, my sister here is going to read 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2.
But have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth of commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God.
Okay, 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2.
Sorry.
Go ahead. That's all right. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2.
Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful.
Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Right? Faithful. Now, Titus, all right. Titus chapter 1 and verse 7. A steward must be blameless. Titus chapter 1 and verse 7. Somebody read that one for me.
For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre.
Yes. Luke. Thank you, Filthy Luca. So the bishop, as a steward of God, must be blameless. Is my time finished? must be blameless. The steward must be blameless. Now, let's go over to a few things we want to look at. What are some of the things that we can steward? Mm-hmm. There's a whole heap. What you've mentioned some of them already, but I want to hear them coming out. What are some of the things that we can steward or we are supposed to steward?
Time.
Talent. So your talent, time, your time, and your talents, meaning your giftings and your abilities. Yes? Moving.
And your money.
Your money. Say it again. Your money.
Your money.
Thank you very much. As you talk about your money, I remember there was a cartoon that I saw, and the preacher was baptizing a young man. And the preacher says to the young man, after today, everything that goes under the water belongs to God. You see, when the next panel, he's under the water, but his hand is above the water with his money. Your money. Yes? Come, what else? What else? What else? Your household, your family. Your family and all that is in your house. Do you know that you're a steward of the dog and the cat? Yes. Not the rat. Not the rat. The rat is not your responsibility. Leave the rat out. But you must, yes, you must steward the dog and the cat and the bird. Whatever animals, whatever pets you have in your home. The furniture. Because remember what our definition was? You must preserve it. You must keep it. You must prevent it from falling apart. So guess what? Lord, deliver me for not being a good steward of the cure. Because sometimes the cure no look good at all. He dirty. Yes, but our homes, our buildings. Yes. What? Come again. Yes. So I heard time, talents, money. What else?
Your
church. Your church. You must be a good steward of your church. Hallelujah. I heard somebody else say something. Good steward of what? Of your pastor?
If it's so in the kingdom of God, you have to water it to let it go. I mean, if you plant a seed in the ground, if you don't water it, it won't germinate.
Thank you very much. All right. So the seed that has been planted, you have to steward it. Somebody say you have to be a good steward of your pastor. Pastor Mash, are they stewarding you well? Talk the truth. Talk the truth. Are they stewarding you well? You must make sure that you preserve her. She must look beautiful. She must not fall apart. That's your responsibility. Amen.
A good steward of your body.
Who said that? Who said that? Where is the person that said that? Let me look upon your body. Stand up. You look good, girl. You look good. Brethren, we must be, and I believe that we are falling down in this era. Talk truth. Talk truth. We must be good stewards of our body. It's not just about overeating. But many of us, me guilty, not getting enough rest. Because there is so many things to do. So you're not going to bed on time. Not getting enough rest. Some of us, we work so hard. You're not even want to take 2 days off from work. Right? Sometimes we stress out the little body. Married people don't stress out the body. The body need rest too. Amen. Good stewards, and not to mention what we eat and how we eat. Good stewards of the body. I heard some more. Anymore?
Good stewards of the food that is provided and natural resources.
The food and natural resources. Can I tell you my story? I remember when I was a child, whenever mommy would give me dinner, I was not a good steward because I used to eat half of it and then me tip to a hide and go throw the rest outside. Because I grew up with my grand aunt. And one day she catch me. She said, come here. Do you know how many people in Africa don't have food to eat and you are wasting the food? I tell you, from that, she said, all you needed to do is just tell me to put less on the plate. So guess what, guys? We need to be good stewards of the resources that have been given to us. We should not be wasting things. We should not be wasting water. We should not be wasting food. Even the electricity. Do you know that we need to be more conscious? Yeah, we need to be more conscious. You're in a home. Do you know that even at my workplace, Pastor Madge, if I'm leaving, I'm turning off the fan, I'm turning off the light. Because sometimes, because it's not ours, we just walk gone, left it. Listen, I got to talk my story now. Me at work, and me hear the toilet running. You tell somebody. You do something about it because we are stewards. We're not to waste the food and the resources, right? Anybody else?
Good stewards of each other.
Oh, Lord. We must be good stewards of each other. We must care about each other. And when you see something happening to your brother or your sister, you don't just turn a blind eye. If you can offer help, you do, yes.
Good steward for the next generation.
Come here. Oh, you're so bright. Come here, man. Come here, man. Come here. Listen. Turn around there. Listen to me. Do you know how important that point is? Because guess what? If the generation that has the responsibility now, Sister Dorcas, don't steward and preserve, then when they come up, what are they going to be inheriting? What are they going to be inheriting? By the time them for rule the world pop down. Right? Just as oh, if your parents rich. Look here, me go talk about the DJ them. Look here, me always say, you will get this millions and billions of dollars. No, make sure say you don't frass out everything. Woo! Woo! Make sure say you have money left for your children, them and your grandchildren. Thank you for that one. Amen. We need to be good stewards for the next generation. The next generation. I have a couple here. 1 Peter 4 and verse 10 says that we are to be stewards of the grace of God. That's what 1 Peter 4 and verse 10 says. We are to be stewards of the grace of God. Was there somebody over here? Yes, my little friend here.
Surrounding of your home.
The surrounding of your home. Listen to me. Sometimes your house can look so nice. And then when you check a stop, outside looks so, you know? So, yes, thank you very much. Sometimes the money is not there as we would like, but yes. The surrounding of your home. So 1 Peter 4:10 says we must be stewards of the grace of God. This is the one that I like. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 1. I want somebody to read that one. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 1. I'm coming down. I'm just going to pick out a few pointers from the text that we read, and then I'll be through. Somebody have 1 Corinthians 4, verse 1?
Let
Over here.
Let a man so account of us, us of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God.
Look here. Thank you very much. Did you hear that? We are stewards of the mysteries of God. When we talk about mysteries, you know, we're talking about things that are not so obvious. We're talking about revelations of God that are not revealed to everybody. So Paul is actually saying that as stewards, it is our responsibility to go deep, to dig deep into God, to pull out the mysteries and revelations that are so important for our continued dominion in the earth. Look here. The adversaries are getting wiser. The weapons of the warfare are getting more sophisticated. So we have to make sure that we dive into God, pull out those mysteries, so that we can remain relevant in our time. Right? We are stewards of the mysteries of God. Now, Luke chapter 16, verse 3 to 4. And my point is this. The steward can be fired. I know you didn't want to hear that one day, no. But the steward, if the steward is not loyal, if the steward is disobedient, unfaithful, and all of those things, the steward can be fired. Luke chapter 16. Now, the entire scripture is Luke 16, 1 to 10. I just want you to read verse 3 and 4. Luke chapter 16, verse 3 and 4. Who's going to read that one for me? Luke chapter 16, 3 to 4. Okay, I have a young lady here. Go ahead.
Then the steward said within himself, What shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I am ashamed to beg.
The master has taken away the stewardship from me. The steward can be fired. And I'm sure that there isn't anyone here that wants to be in that position where you're fired. So, just a few points from the Matthew 25 text and then I'll close. So somebody might be saying, but you know, so many Old Testament and it's from Old Testament, so that is not relevant for our time. Absolutely not. That is not true. It's very much relevant now as it was then. Because Matthew 25, notice how the passage begins. It says, for the kingdom of heaven. So it tells me that stewardship is a kingdom initiative. Stewardship is a kingdom initiative. So it tells the story of a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. Tell me in that story, my young persons, I want a young person to answer this. Who in the story represents God and who in the story represents the steward? Who, come on, I heard it. Who in the story represents God and who in the story represents the steward? Let me hear it. The servants, they are the stewards. And who represents God? The owner, the man traveling. All right, so the man traveling is the owner and the stewards are the servants. And what is the resources? Okay, what was delivered unto them? The goods, right? So listen to this now. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. The point I want you to get from that is that not everybody receives the same amount of resources. And many times, the resources that you receive to steward is based on your capacity. Yeah, there are some persons who have the capacity. You ever see some people who just multi-talented, pastor? Them can do everything. Them can work in any department. They can do anything that you ask them to do in the church, because they have the capacity. They have a greater capacity. So not everybody. So some get 5, some got 2, some get 1. But the important thing is that whatever it is that you have been given, you must steward it well. You no better look upon the person who get 5. Work with your 1. Whatever it is that you can do. Right? If all you can do is read the scriptures, praise the Lord. If that's all you can do, read it well. Make sure when you're done, read it, everybody say, wow. You know, you have some people who read very well, don't it? All right. So we see that they were given based on their ability. Now, then he that hath received the 5 talents went and traded it. The same with the 2, went and traded it. But he that had received 1 went and digged it in the earth and hid his Lord's money. Remember, what was the mandate that was given unto us in Genesis 1? Verse 27 or 28. What was the mandate? Come, say it. You have it. Say it. You have it, man. Be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply. So the one who got the 5 decided that he was going to follow God's instruction and be fruitful and multiply the 5. The one who got the 2 followed the same principle and decided to be fruitful and multiply. But the one who get the 1, what did he do? He hid it. And then when the master came, him faced upon top of it. He hid it and then him faced it. So hold on there. My Lord, I know that you always come and take where you have not sowed. So I decided to hide it. What was God's response? So this is a principle. And this is a very important principle that we need to learn. Your faithfulness as a steward determines your dominion. Your faithfulness as a steward determines your dominion. If you notice what happened, the one who came up with the 5 other, what did Jesus say to him? Let's go back to it. The one who got the 5, his Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Look here, you can steward $10,000, but you want God to make you into a billionaire. Huh? And you can't steward $10,000 well. Listen, you want to be a billionaire, make sure that you are savvy with that $10,000. So first of all, you make sure that you tithe from that $10,000, and then the 90% of that $10,000, when you done with it, listen, there are some good lady stewards in this place, you know. Because when them get that salary, that is not so plenty. And when them work it, you would have think that them are the billionaire. Because what they're able to do. So if you want to be, if you want to have dominion and to be somebody who is stewarding a lot, you have to show that you can steward a little. And the last servant who hid the one, he said, "You wicked and slothful servant." And what did God do? He took away what he had and gave it to the one who showed himself to be fruitful. Listen, if time would allow, I would touch on the tithing. But I don't think I need to, because I think the point is here that we must be good stewards of our money. And the first part of that is to ensure that what belongs to the owner, he gets it. Because it is his. Listen, if you live in a rented house, and there are fruit trees on that property, do you know that the owner has the right to walk in at any time and pick off as much fruit as they want because they own it? Did you know that? It's their property, and everything on that property, well, not everything, your furniture don't belong to them, but the trees belong to them, and they can come and pick off. Now, out of etiquette and good relationship and, you know, all of that, but the point is they have the right. And I'm saying that God has given us the ability, the responsibility to steward the wealth, the resources that he gives us. It is only out of love, and it should be out of love, that we, as a part of our stewardship, are willing to give back to the Lord. Hallelujah. So we bless you, Father God, today. We thank you, Lord, that you have counted us faithful. You have counted us faithful, Jesus, to deposit all of these giftings and abilities into us. And so, Lord, even now we ask that you will help us. Help us, Father, to steward what you have given us well. Help us, Lord, that we would be found faithful so that, God, our dominion can increase. We thank you for all of the blessings that you have given unto us. And we make our commitment, Almighty God, to give what is yours back to you. We give you honor, praise, and glory in Jesus' name. God bless you. God bless you.
Continue clapping, man. Continue clapping. Bless you, Pastor Mir. It was a beautiful lesson, right? We have learned a lot, not true? We have learned a whole heap of concepts and aspects of stewardship. Can you, anybody, throw out some of the characteristics that was mentioned? Throw out some to me. Integrity, compassion, right? Consistent. What else?
Liar.
Obedience, right? Honest, right? So all of these are beautiful characteristics of stewardship. And what are some of the things that we can steward? Our time, right? What else? Money. What else? Our body. My brother Matthew said the younger generation or the next generation. What else? or environment, right? So all of these are different aspects and things that we have taken away from the lesson. And I pray and I hope that you as well as well grasp some things as well. So let us point our hands to Pastor Sophie Mayer and just say, may the Lord bless her. So God bless you, Pastor. So God bless you, Pastor. Yes, man, bless her, bless her, bless her, bless her. So before we close, I know that we were, you know, looking at stewardship and all of these things, but I'm not sure if anybody here, you know, during the lesson, the Lord has pricked you to say, you know, this stewardship, I believe is something that I want to try and, you know, make a change in my life and become a Christian. So I'm inviting anybody who is not a Christian to make themselves to the front, to make their way to the front. Anyone? Going once, twice, three times. All right. So, most righteous and heavenly Father, as we come before your presence, we just honor your name and we tell you thanks one more time for allowing us to be here, allowing us to get this lesson about being good stewards. Because sometimes we really don't look at the concept and we just believe that it's just about giving of money alone that makes us be a good steward. But it's a whole thing. You know, it's not just about giving our money, but it's about giving our time or giving ourselves, giving our different resources, managing it well. And sometimes some of us are not very good managers, but we have seen different stories and different examples of your people being good managers. And we also see people in the Bible that have been slothful with their money and their earnings. But I pray, Father God, that as we go forward as stewards, that we will learn and hold on to these concepts and these teachings of how to be good stewards, Father God. And also in the time of being a good steward, that we'll also give thanks for all the things that we have got, Father God. Can you never forgive it to us? You know, but because of your grace and your mercy, you have provided all of these things, all of these assets, all of these resources, our time, our very self. And this is how we can give it back to you to uplift and to build upon the kingdom of God. So Lord, continue to have your way in our lives as we go forward. Bless us, Lord. Keep us, sanctify us in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. So I just want to say thank you all for coming out this morning, you know, to another Sunday morning service. Today was our youth empowerment. I hope that you all have been blessed. I hope you all have learned a lot from the lessons and the different things that was taught this morning. If you have your thought this morning, I bless each and every one of you. I just want to say thank you all for being here and making Church of God of Prophecy the church of choice. Bless you all. Let us say the benediction. Let us all stand for today's benediction.